Well, it's spring in the city of Spokane and definitely spring here in Riverfront Park. Hello, I'm Karen Stratton and I am your city council member from the 3rd District in Spokane. Many of you remember last spring the numbers, the hundreds of scooters and bicycles that filled our streets downtown and in some of our neighborhoods. Those scooters and bicycles were part of what we call the shared mobility program that we're here to learn more about today, because it's not going to be too much longer. We're going to see more of those scooters and bicycles, we hope, down in the downtown area. So joining me today to learn more about this program is Brandon Blankenagel, who is a engineer for the city of Spokane, has worked very, very hard on the program, and Ryan Patterson, who is the chair of the Bicycle Advisory Board. Thank you both for being here.
Thank you.
So I'm going to start with you. Let's talk a little bit about shared mobility, the program, how it was conceived, and where you plan to go with it.
Sure. So shared mobility, or bike share, it was formerly known because it was predominantly bicycles, has been of interest to many cities and became a part of conversations here in Spokane back in 2012, 2013, 2014. We actually wrote a grant to be able to study and prepare for bike share working in Spokane. At that time, we were looking at docked bike share. Last fall, when this system was in operation, it was a dockless system where the bikes don't have to be parked in a specific set of biking, you know, parking areas where you check the bikes out from. They're all independently operated. They connect with a GPS unit and actually function on their own. So they don't have to have this big dock that they're checked out from and operated from. So this dockless program is more flexible. It can reach further into the community and serve more people. It's a great opportunity for us to take and expand our active transportation program here in Spokane and give people a chance to get around town in a way that's flexible and even fun. So,
can you talk a little bit about the numbers that you saw last spring of individuals that were trying out these bikes and scooters?
Yeah, so we put the bikes down and we had anywhere from 300 to 700 vehicles, and that's scooters and bikes, over the period of performance. And there were about 100 days that we were operating. We saw over 140,000 rides, and they covered close to 150,000 miles in terms of the combined usage. So a lot of people were using the bikes and scooters. To look at how far out into the city they operated, while we concentrated the vehicles in the downtown, we saw them expand to all the limits of the city and even beyond the city. So it was exciting to see how many people and how far spread the system operated.
And as this pilot program was discussed, what was the role, if any, or the discussion within the Bicycle Advisory Board among avid bicyclists that were also going to be on the streets with the scooters and the electric bikes?
Well, we talked about them, I mean, for years coming up, talking about what the pilot program might end up being, what kind of program might work best for Spokane. And especially, you know, when the grant was for a study and the opportunity to actually have a pilot on the ground in place of just having someone come in and study it, we saw it as an even more effective way to find out what Spokane wants and what Spokane will use. We, of course, discussed all of the things, the hurdles that might be in the way, specifically the helmet ordinance, and tried to look at other cities to see how that was handled across the country. Because bike share is becoming more and more popular.
Throughout the whole country?
Throughout the whole country, yeah.
So talking about helmets, I've heard a lot that this is an application-based rental program where people get the bikes and the scooters from their phones. They can do everything on the phone. So how do you, and we've had some of these discussions before, when dealing with safety and helmets, where do we go with that? Because it's obvious if you do this all by your phone, there's no helmet that you can, unless you bring your own, there's no place to get a helmet. Talk a little bit about the thought that's gone into that.
Sure. So traditionally, if you were going to rent a bike in a city that you were visiting, or just to try biking out in a certain location, you would be doing that from a building that would have, ideally, a stock of helmets that they could give you with the bike. Where this is a single person checking out the vehicle, nobody's handing you a helmet, you're responsible essentially to bring your own helmet to operate it safely. We did have some laws on the books here that said that a vendor had to distribute a helmet with a bike when they were renting it out. That has been adjusted such that bike share itself can operate on its own without having the requirement to supply that helmet. But one of the things that we're working on is making sure that our vendor here operating in Spokane will have the opportunity for everyone who is going to use the system to access a helmet nearby. So we'll be stocking those helmets in certain locations and providing indications within the application where you can get a helmet and use it. But generally, we would expect those who are going to use the system to use good judgment and operate and bring their own helmet to use the bikes and scooters.
Be safe. And with the program, the pilot program, were there surveys done to get input and ideas from the citizens of what they'd like to see, or if they liked it, if they'd use them again if they came back?
Yeah, so we did an extensive survey that invited people to provide feedback about how they use the system, what they might use the system for if they hadn't used it, or what limited them from using it. We had a lot of great answers in that regard. Some people felt like we needed better infrastructure, so we need more bike lanes, more ways that they can use it safely. A lot of folks were interested in using it for recreation, but as we also saw throughout the time period that the bikes were on the ground, people started using it more and more for business. So going from meeting to meeting across town was a very simple way to get around, and it started to be adopted more as a transportation function more than a recreation. So a lot of great things that we heard from the public from that survey.
So we're talking, I know that there was some concerns about bicycles and scooters coming through the park, sidewalks. Talk a little bit, because I think the cool thing that they can turn them down.
Sure,
turn your speed
sure.
down. Yeah. So when you're in a place you're not supposed to be, or you got to go slow, it automatically slows down. Can you talk about that a little bit?
Sure, yeah. So because the bikes are all GPS enabled, and they're constantly speaking with the system that operates them, we can actually set, for instance, here in Riverfront Park, you have a speed limit. And we can set a speed limit on the scooters that will allow them to operate only up to that speed. So when you enter into the park, the scooters will coast down to that allowable speed and then go through at that appropriate speed. And when you exit the park, it will speed back up to the typical speed that you would use outside of the park. So
it is very neat to see what
the technology can do.
I was going to say, one of the things that I think is really great about this conversation that we're having now surrounding the shared mobility project is that it brings to light a lot of issues that have kind of been simmering in the background but haven't really been discussed publicly, like the issue with people riding bikes or scooters on the sidewalks.
Yes.
That's been a law on the books for years now. And I've talked to people who've been riding their bike in Spokane for 30 plus years and had no idea, because it's kind of, there's an invisible boundary
right
around downtown. So how do we, it lets us kind of start the conversation of, how do we do that education? How do we let people know what the rules are so that everyone is safe sharing the downtown space?
And everyone gets involved in the conversation, which is
right.
just what you want, right? To get the feedback and get close to what people want.
Yeah.
What about injuries? I know I've heard from constituents that they worry a little bit about if somebody doesn't have a helmet. Did we have a lot of big injuries during the pilot?
So we definitely heard about several types of injuries that happened throughout the pilot period. People that had fallen and gotten scrapes, up to broken bones and arms and legs. These are things that happen on bikes and scooters, and is part of the risk of using a program like that. But there's also risk when you get out and drive or when you're walking in our right-of-way, you know, where you have all these things going on and our abilities, sometimes we overestimate what we can do safely. And so we definitely encourage everyone as they use this system to be respectful of others and to be cognizant of their own skill set so that they're the most careful that they can be. Again, you know, always wear a helmet as you go out and use these programs, especially if you feel like this is something new to you. Operate that with care and just be wise about how you're operating. One of the things that came up so often in our pilot program was the sidewalk use.
Yes.
We had scooters on the sidewalk in the downtown and they're going very, very fast for sidewalk type traffic. So that big speed differential is a concern. And most people who were riding the scooters probably felt pretty comfortable, but the people walking did not feel comfortable with those scooters coming at them. And so not knowing what those people's skill set were, you know, who were driving that scooter, it just gives you a lot of discomfort. So we need to be respectful of each other as we operate in, you know, on our streets and around the downtown especially.
And you do have to be a certain age, right, to take one of these
out? I believe over 16 or over 18?
Over 18.
To legally, use the app to check out a vehicle.
Yeah.
One more question, dealing with the usage in the neighborhoods. So I live in Northwest Spokane. Those things, I saw them everywhere in West Central, people riding them from downtown to West Central. Was there any number counting or any surveying done in how many were actually taken out into the neighborhoods?
So we did track the usage, and when we looked at just the month of October, for instance, the vehicles were used on every street within a 2.5 mile radius of our downtown. Every single street
That's
had been
amazing.
Ridden on in the month of October, and they had also expanded the use. I mean, we saw tracks of them being used throughout the city, nearly every street, all, you know, throughout the full boundaries of the city. So it definitely got a lot of great usage all over. And as we expand, the pilot was really concentrated in the downtown area. As we expand that out further into our neighborhoods, we'll probably see more usage yet.
And because it's dockless, the vendor can change and update that as they see where the need and where the use is. So we're not stuck with like the neighborhood that was picked for, you know, X amount of months or years. If we see a need in a different part of the city, if we want to make it available to more people in the Northeast, or we just have to, they reset the bikes in the evening. And so they'll just put them in those places where to make them available.
So that's a big mystery question. This is my last question. At night, I would leave work and there would be, you know, people on scooters at some parked on the sidewalk all over the place. And I'd come back in the morning and it's orderly and they're cleaned and they're, you know, standing up ready for use. What happens at night to these things?
So that's the charging time for the system. So they actually, they actually paid people to pick up those vehicles and charge them overnight and then bring them back out and set them orderly out in wherever order or areas they have programmed for the use. So they were laid out nice and orderly every morning.
It was amazing to see
that. That's one of the aspects of it, yeah.
That's wonderful.
And it's always a good example too for people to be able to see that every day. There's no risk of it staying unorderly because every night they're picked up, they're put back where they should be.
Cleaned
it's like
up,
someone, you know, putting away their toys at night. So even if they do, and hopefully people will see that and start to learn where are the best spots to park these, you know, where on the sidewalk, is it out of the way, and it's still accessible.
Okay, well, thank you so much. I think the next conversation we're gonna have is about public safety and the downtown area and what the transportation has done in the downtown area, what it's done for the businesses, and we'll be right back.
I don't remember how it started.
North of that.
Our back and forth. It always came back.
Dad!
You probably don't remember what you told me.
That was perfect.
But I heard every word.
Me and my boy Matt had it good.
He had catnip that was off the hook. But one day, he brings a girl home, and she's allergic to cats. Every sneeze was a nail in my coffin. Now I'm in a shelter. It's decent, but they don't even have Wi-Fi.
When is less really more? Less time in the shower means more savings for you. A 5-minute shower cuts your utility bill and saves our water supply. Go to slowtheflowspokane.com to find out more ways to use less water.
Every day, we go about our lives driven by routine. Our vision is clouded by the very normalcy we take for granted. Countless victims of human trafficking walk among us, invisible, until now. The Blue Campaign provides a unified voice for those who combat human trafficking. Whether it's forced labor, domestic servitude, or the sex trade, it's time to open our eyes. Learn what you can do to help by visiting dhs.gov/bluecampaign.
Welcome back. With me now is Mark Richard, who is president of the Downtown Spokane Partnership, and John O'Brien with the Spokane Police Department. We're going to talk a little bit about public safety, businesses downtown, and the scooters and bicycles. So, Mark, I'm going to start with you.
All right.
I have to tell you, I saw a picture in the newspaper of you on a scooter, taking off, going to a meeting. Tell me about that and your personal experience with the scooters and bicycles.
Well, it wasn't superimposed. That was me. My personal experience was just probably started out with a little bit of excitement and tension. We weren't quite sure how it was all going to play out on the sidewalks and the streets, but my own personal feeling is I had a blast. I mean, they are they're just a fun way to commute around downtown. I found myself going back and forth to meetings, using them as an inner downtown commuter vehicle, and they were so efficient, so reasonably priced, and such a blast.
You didn't have to get your car out and drive around, and
yeah.
You were just... And what about a helmet? Did you have a helmet? Did you worry about helmets or how you were going to get one? Or,
you know, I didn't. I probably should have. I spent much of my time on the sidewalks, but
going slow, I
did end up out on the street. Probably mostly because you saw the entire community doing the same thing.
Right,
I suppose
right.
I felt like wasn't absolutely necessary, but.
Right. But you felt safe on it.
I did,
yes.
Yeah,
good.
Yeah. I mean, it's I'm not young anymore, so I got to be honest. I think it took me a minute to kind of find my balance and my mm-hmm. bearings. But if a guy my age can ride a scooter as I did, anybody can. Yeah.
Feedback from businesses downtown. What were you hearing from people? Were there concerns, complaints? Were people happy about them, or just? I know a lot of us in City Hall were just kind of in awe watching them all over the place.
Us too. You know, we, much like you, our office is a little above the sidewalk, so we got to watch just with
right.
amazement and awe and joy, frankly, at all the people just having a great time. Most of the feedback, I'd say 95% of it was super positive. I think the what we saw and heard was it was helping to drive people's cash register. People were coming downtown intentionally to ride these scooters.
That's pretty
cool.
And
it was really exciting. And so I think in terms of commerce, we saw a lift in that. And again, just the energy of people having fun, big smiles on their faces, cruising around town, stopping and having dinner, having a cup of coffee, what have you, was I think everybody benefited. We heard a couple of concerns about scooters left in front of a doorway here or there, and then of course the issue that you guys addressed, frankly, with the change in your ordinance, and that is a real concern about the confluence of the scooter on the sidewalk.
Right.
I was very careful and cautious because that's my job,
right.
is to make sure that I'm attentive to those things. But we had some younger folks that were out in full throttle on the sidewalk, and there were a couple close encounters with people that were pedestrians. Other than that, I would say the feedback was from our businesses and community, the visitors, was all nothing but positive.
That's wonderful. And any improvements you'd like to see this time around when we get them back on the ground?
Well, I think you addressed it. Honestly, Councilwoman, I think the thing in terms of regulating now that they should be out on the street, I think that really addressed it, because we need to have a safe passage for mm-hmm. our pedestrians on our sidewalks. My only hope would be, and I've talked a little bit about this with the representative from Lyme, is that the city could see its way maybe to spending a few dollars to enhance and to expand our bike lanes in the downtown area, because
be nice.
Now that we put them out on the street, we need to make sure that they're safe.
They're safer.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
And I think we could do some fun things with them, frankly. I think, you know, if you thought about even some dedicated bike lanes, maybe we paint them in a lime green or something, you
yeah.
know, just to have a little fun and draw attention to the fact that these things are in our community. And
yeah, you could definitely just feel the energy
yeah.
in the fall when just walking around and they were all over the place.
Oh, you couldn't help but have a smile on your face. I saw businessmen and women. I saw women in dresses. I mm-hmm. saw women, you know, in what I would say is kind of religious garb, full head. I don't know what you call it—a bonnet almost of—and dresses down to their shoes
on scooters. So
on scooters, and the biggest smiles and laughter you've ever seen in your life. And it was just
that's so great.
And I think that's what I would say is that if you're a little shy or sheepish or uncertain, I would, you know, we saw folks from 12 probably to 70
yeah.
on these scooters come down and give them a try.
Wonderful.
Yeah.
Thank you, officer. Let's
yes.
talk a little bit about. I know that there have been some public safety concerns, and police officers downtown especially. Are there issues related to these scooters and bicycles that the community needs to know about? Are there concerns that the police have that they would rather not have to deal with that we could maybe educate people on?
Sure. Well, our focus is safety. Safety for the person enjoying their ride on the scooter, and safety for the community that's on the sidewalks, using the crosswalks to cross the street. When you're enjoying that scooter on the roadway, hopefully using a bike lane, you act like you're in a vehicle and you're aware of your surroundings, other vehicle traffic, pedestrians. If we do that and we ride with kindness and look out for one another, it's going to reduce, I think, a lot of the frustrations people have had in the past where they thought scooter riders weren't being considerate and they were speeding on the sidewalks, like Mark had mentioned earlier. I think we can work together here, and the police department will have an education piece in that as well. When we do find somebody that's riding on the sidewalk, riding recklessly, we can stop them and have a conversation and say, let's keep the community safe. Let's make our visitors that are here have a wonderful experience in Spokane and have nothing but great things to say about it.
So when you are stopping people who aren't being considerate, is there a warning that they get, or is it just a conversation that, you know, let's try and be safe? And
it starts as a conversation. A warning can be built into that, you know, and our focus is not to punish a person, some might think, or to write them an infraction. It's an education piece so that they know how, what the rules are, how to behave on those to keep themselves and the community safe.
Great. Anything you saw this past during the pilot project that you would you liked, or anything that you would change being out there among the riders?
You know, I think I don't want to focus on the negatives, but I think if we just make sure that the people that are enjoying these stay off the sidewalks, because we've had, like Mark mentioned in the past, some people that have ridden at speeds that have caused us to have an ordinance do not ride on the sidewalk. Just be considerate of others and things will flow well.
Wonderful. Mark, any closing reflections? Anything you want to add to your experience?
Well, maybe just two things. I think, again, if you haven't been downtown in a while, or even if you haven't been on one of these scooters, so you can experience and you can traverse our downtown, you can make your way up the river and up to the Gonzaga campus and just enjoy that experience, and really from a different perspective. I really encourage people to do that, because it was really something special, and I think it's a nice add that you guys made to our community. I would echo this, and that is that not everybody is conscientious of their fellow human being on the sidewalk, or
right.
you know, and so I would say, you know, just be careful, be mindful, and be smart. Yeah, you know, traffic down here is moving a little bit slower. It might feel like it's a little bit safer, but you're interfacing with vehicles, you know,
right.
3 to 10,000 pound vehicles, you know, and then you're interfacing with people that, you know, that you also put in harm's way if you're not being careful and mindful of your you know, your fellow pedestrian or your fellow scooter rider. So just be careful, be smart, and have fun. Mm-hmm.
And maybe when they come back this spring, you and I can host a little session here in the ice ribbon for those of us that have never ridden them.
We'll do a tutorial.
And we'll get on them and show people that anybody can do
this.
All right. Okay. Thank you so much. And we'll be right back.
When I was your age, I was just like you, fascinated by stars. But now I get to search for life in the universe. And who knows, maybe life is looking for us too.
So we're like aliens to them?
Yeah. Does anyone want to be a scientist now?
I do.
Awesome. We need more girls in STEM.
Maybe we can find aliens.
Here you go.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Let me tell you about the toughest guy on earth. He has the crazy strength to lift the man that raised him up without even flinching. This guy, no, this warrior, will always be by his father's side, even if his dad will hardly remember. If this guy isn't the toughest guy on the planet, then I don't know who is. Caregiving is tougher than tough. Find the care guides you need at aarp.org/caregiving.
Losing a bicycle is frustrating. Many bikes are recovered by the police, but getting it back to the owner can be challenging. Help the Spokane Police Department return your bike if it goes missing. Register it online today. Registration is quick, easy, and free. Snap a picture, enter the bike's serial number, give us a description, provide your contact information. Snap, upload, click, registration is that simple. Visit My Spokane section of SpokaneCity.org to learn more or to register your bike for free. Don't have access to a computer? No problem. You can also register your bike at your neighborhood cop's shop.
I'm back with Brandon Blakenagel from the City of Spokane, and we're gonna close this up shortly, but I have a couple more questions.
Sure.
Brandon, what's next for this plan? When can we expect to see them back? And beyond that, what other kind of information do you have?
Sure, so we're working on contract negotiations right now. The goal for us is to get on the ground and kick off again with these scooters and bikes May 13th.
May 13th, okay.
So that's the start of Bike to Work Week.
Okay.
Bike to Work Month, Bike Everywhere Month for that matter. So it's a great opportunity. Our weather is usually very nice. We'll have a great chance to get out there and get those moving. So last year when we closed out, we were right around 500 to 700 vehicles. That's where we're planning to start this year.
Okay.
And the program will probably expand in the community. So that's kind of where we're going in the future. We'll grow this program and it will grow with use. So as people use them more, they'll bring more vehicles out and set them out further out into the city. That's one of the goals that we have. Also, we want to start organizing our parking a little more and start showing infrastructure that will work better for the system. So just helping everyone else to understand where they can park the vehicle. Sometimes that's a little bit of a question, you know? I'm just gonna leave
it. Just
this
leave
here.
It and walk away. Yeah, they're not used to that.
It's a little bit different,
right?
You know, to do that. And so we'll try to start adding some organization to that. It's gonna take a little bit of time because that's an investment. But one of the things that we've done is a recent hire here as a bicycle pedestrian coordinator. And he will be helping manage this program full time. So that'll be great to have somebody that can dedicate more time to the program and keep it lively and moving forward.
And Bike to Work Week, does that have a kickoff event in May?
It does.
Okay.
So Bike to Work Week has a kickoff actually right here at the Skate Ribbon Monday morning, May 13th.
Perfect.
And they have a big pancake breakfast, and it's usually a great time if you want to show up around 7 a.m. or a little bit later if you desire, you know, and come and enjoy good company and music and some little speeches, I think they usually have. And so it's a good time.
Be a celebration.
Yeah.
All right. If people want any more information, just go to the city website at www.bikeforyou.org.
SpokaneCity.org?
Yes.
Okay.
And if you search for shared mobility or WheelShare, we'll have more information coming.
Perfect. Well, that's it. I hope that everybody got a little bit more information and education on bicycles and scooters. This is a personal invitation to everybody in the city of Spokane to come down and celebrate Bike to Work Week starting May 13th. Is that correct?
That's correct.
And if I can get on a scooter and try it out, then you can too. So we hope to see you. Thank you.